Honorable Professor Roger E. Kornberg, Yang Berbahagia, Academician Datuk Seri Dr. Salim Muhammad Nur, Secretary General, Academy of Sciences Malaysia, Yang Berbahagia, Academician Professor Dr. Louis Lai Ming, Council Member and Senior Fellow, Academy of Sciences Malaysia, Yang Berbahagia, Professor Dr. A. Rahman A. Jamal, Director of UBI, University Kebangsaan Malaysia, Mr. Uwe Morawetz, Chairman, National Peace Foundation, fellows of the Academy of Sciences Malaysia, invited guests from institutions of higher learning, research institutes, government ministries and STI professional bodies, postgraduate students, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Good afternoon and welcome to this dialogue by Professor Roger D. Kornberg, Nobel Laureate in Chemistry 2006, on the topic of research on gene expression. This event is organized as part of the Malaysian Bridges event series facilitated by the International Peace Foundation and organized by the Academy of Sciences Malaysia in collaboration with Universiti Kebangsaan Malaysia. Without further delay, it is now a pleasure to call upon Yang Berbahagia Academician Dato' Sri Dr. Salim Muhammad Nur, Secretary General, Academy of Sciences Malaysia, to deliver his welcome remarks.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh and good afternoon. Our honored guest, Professor Kornberg, fellows of the Academy, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the Academy, I wish once again thank all of you for coming. We had this morning session. We had a very, very enjoyable discussion with the public forum with our honored guests. And now we have an opportunity for you scientists to meet up with him, talk to him, ask him questions, and I'm sure it will be a very enlightening, if not historical, occasion for many of you. On behalf of the Academy, we consider this as one of our major achievements, bring budding scientists to meet Nobel laureates with the hope that maybe one day we have amongst you future Nobel laureate of the country. But it's not an easy task, and I'm sure you can ask the Nobel laureate how to become a Nobel laureate. But I'm sure there's no easy answer to it. The Academy does many such forums, scientific orations, public lectures, as part of our effort to encourage the achievement of science. But this effort cannot be undertaken alone, and we need partners, and we are very grateful to UKM, of course, the International Peace Foundation, for the support, and on behalf of the Academy, I would like to thank them individually and collectively. Sekian ucapan ringkas saya, I'm sure you have better for the universe. Thank you, Assalamualaikum.
Thank you, Dato' Sri Saleh. We now invite Mr. Uwe Morawetz, Chairman of the International Peace Foundation, to say a few words.
Increasing ethnic, political, religious and social conflicts and the helplessness to respond to them without further we're stimulating the spiral of violence to show us peace is not a given good. It has to be constantly learned, experienced, and created anew. Peace is not a passive state. Peace is a process which needs time, attention, and the participation of all of us. And peace begins with education. The seeds of peace need to be planted in schools, in universities, in the young generation. This is why the International Peace Foundation cooperates with major schools and universities, as well as with UNESCO in realizing this Bridges program. We believe in the importance of the education and scientific community of Malaysia by bringing the knowledge and wisdom of Nobel laureate for peace, physics, chemistry, medicine, and economics to this country. What these highly in demand Nobel laureates normally see of the country are airports and hotels. They deliver their lecture, stay for one night, and leave. We have invited them here not only to speak, but to share, to engage, to listen. They come here not for one day or one event only, but for various dialogues in different parts of the country, without requesting any honorarium, because of their real interest in building bridges, because of their real interest in religion. It is our hope that these are not the first and final visits of these Nobel laureates, but visits with many fruitful returns to build long-lasting friendships and to start, for instance, research programs or other forms of cooperation with the local universities and schools. This is how bridges could develop into a long-term and sustainable success for Malaysia to strengthen education as a basis for peace. I thank the Academy of Sciences Malaysia and the organizing committee of today's event for taking up this opportunity of our cooperation and for inviting today the 2006 Nobel Laureate in Chemistry, Professor Roger Kornberg, to this prestigious institution. We look forward to this dialogue and to the important contribution to the bridges.
Thank you, Mr. Morawetz. Ladies and gentlemen, without any further delay, we now hand the floor to Academician Professor Dr. Lee Langley, Council Member and Senior Fellow, Academy of Sciences Malaysia, to introduce the Nobel Laureate and moderate the session.
Good afternoon. It is a pleasure to introduce Nobel Laureate, Professor Roger Kornberg, who has graciously agreed to dialogue this afternoon with our Malaysian researchers. It's difficult to be brief when introducing someone with such a distinguished CV. But in the interest of time, I will try to be brief because the dialogue is more important than my introduction. And also, you already have quite a bit of information about him in the brochures. Well, Roger David Kornberg was born in Missouri, USA, and he earned his bachelor's degree in chemistry from Harvard University, his PhD in chemistry from Stanford University. In his doctoral research, he demonstrated the diffusional motions of lipids in membranes to flip-flop and lateral diffusion techniques, which I believe proved to be hugely useful later in his Nobel Prize winning work. While a postdoctoral fellow working with Aaron Clark and Francis Crick, both of Nobel Prize fame, at the MRC Laboratory of Molecular Biology in Cambridge, England, in the 1970s, Kornberg discovered a nucleosome as the basic protein complex between chromosomal DNA in the nucleus of eukaryotic cells. He later returned to Stanford as professor of structural biology, where his research has focused on the mechanism and regulation of eukaryotic gene transcription. As many of you may be aware, Professor Kornberg's father, Arthur Kornberg, enlisted us in 2002. I was also a professor at Stanford University and awarded the Nobel Prize in Physiology of Medicine in 1959 for discovering how genetic information is transferred from one DNA molecule to another in a process called DNA replication. Now, we know how extremely important DNA is to biological life, but the understanding of life will never be complete without the kind of discoveries that Professor Roger Kornberg has made. Findings that contribute to understanding how the silent information contained in DNA is processed to create the proteins that carry out the functions of life. Today, schools all over the world describe and teach these fundamental steps. When a cell expresses a gene, it copies or transcribes that gene's DNA sequence into a messenger RNA sequence, and the mRNA is transported out of the nucleus to ribosomes. The ribosomes read the mRNA and translate the code into the right amino acid sequence to make that gene's protein. It was fascinating and complicated in the days when I was in school, but there was even more to come. Professor Roger Kornberg's studies of the processes of this transcription have extended over 30 years with many milestone discoveries along the way. His discovery that the great complexity of eukaryotic organisms is actually enabled by the fine interplay between tissue-specific substances enhances the DNA, and a remarkable protein complex, dubbed mediator, was hailed by the Nobel Prize Committee as a true milestone in the understanding of the transcription process. Kornberg also devoted two decades to the development of methods to visualize the atomic structure of RNA polymerase and its associated protein components. The truly revolutionary aspect of the picture Kornberg has created is that it captures the process of transcription in full flow. What we see is an RNA strand being constructed, and hence the exact positions of the DNA polymerase and RNA during this process. Now, understanding how transcription works is not just of scientific interest. It is of fundamental medical importance, as disturbances in the transcription process are involved in many human illnesses such as cancer, heart disease, and various kinds of inflammation. Professor Kornberg's research helps explain how disease can result when transcription goes wrong and offers the potential for unlocking new therapeutic approaches. Scientific reasoning appears to be a strong trait in the Kornberg family. Arthur Kornberg isolated the first enzyme capable of synthesizing DNA, bacterial DNA polymerase 1. And Kornberg's younger brother, Thomas Bill Kornberg, discovered DNA polymerases 2 and 3. All three Kornbergs have thus worked to understand how genetic information is put to use in cells. There's obviously great passion for science in the Kornberg family. And we are therefore very honored to have Professor Kornberg with us this afternoon to share that passion. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor. I thank you, ladies and gentlemen. I'm pleased to be here, and I know that the majority of the time will be devoted to a conversation. I look forward to that. I thought I might begin by trying to establish a common ground. So I'll speak to you in very general terms about my research over the past 20 to 30 years, and in particular about the work mentioned in this very kind and generous introduction for which I received the Prize of Chemistry. Again, what I have to tell you now has the purpose of establishing common ground, so it's very general. I think almost everything I will tell you in the next few minutes by way of introduction to our dialogue, almost all of you know, but in case there is anything that would be new to anybody, it may be worth mentioning as a basis for our discussion. And even if you know it already, you may enjoy hearing it again. As you've already heard, the topic of our work over the past very many years has been the way in which information in DNA is put to use in cells, ultimately for the production of protein. And as the slide indicates, and probably all of you are aware, This is a two-step process in which the information DNA is first transcribed to make an RNA message, and then subsequently translated to an encoding. Now, this first step begins, of course, with the DNA itself, the double helix of Watson and Crick fame, well-known, I'm sure, to everyone in the room. DNA consists of two complementary strands, which must be separated for the process of transcription by the molecule of RNA polymerase, which has been the focus of my research. The RNA polymerase symbolized in this picture by a reddish-colored ellipsoid has the capacity, first, to separate the two strands of the DNA double helix. Second, to synthesize an RNA molecule, which is shown here in blue. And then in the wake of transcription, the DNA already transcribed will rejoin and reform a double helix. Now, the process of transcription by RNA polymerase is catalyzed not only by RNA polymerase, but it is supported by many additional molecules. The RNA polymerase itself is made up of not one, but a dozen different proteins. It is a true molecular machine. That dozen proteins is still not sufficient for the process. In the end, as we have discovered over the past period of time, some 60 protein molecules come together to enable both accurate transcription and a response to regulatory influences, which may come from within the body or from the environment. Now, a protein which is the ultimate product of transcription and translation is, as you know, a chain of amino acids that folds upon itself in a compact form. As I have already mentioned, the RNA polymerase is made of a dozen such proteins, and again, to repeat, 60 molecules of this type collaborate to accomplish the entire process of transcription in its full complexity. The DNA molecule that forms or that contains all the genetic information, as you may also, as you're doubtless all aware, is an exceedingly long, thin, if you will, thread-like molecule. The human genome resides in DNA 1 meter long. That 1 meter length of DNA must be compressed a millionfold, so it will be accommodated within the nucleus of any cell of our bodies, approximately 1 micrometer in extent. The problem of how DNA is packaged in this manner was an outstanding question for most of the past century. It had long been known from light microscopy, such as the picture shown in this slide, that the DNA is most condensed in mitosis. You see an example of the chromosomes of a dividing cell at the upper left, as they move towards the opposite poles of the daughters of a cell division. At the end of cell division, shown beneath that picture, the chromosomes unfold to allow expression of the genetic information. In some cases, we can actually directly visualize what has occurred upon unfolding, and those are the two examples shown at the right from the process of gamete or germ cell formation in an amphibian in the middle, and from the salivary gland of a fruit fly at the far right. Now, the question, as I say, of how DNA is compressed in the nucleus of a cell, how a meter length of human DNA can be accommodated within a 1 micrometer nucleus of a human cell was a question, indeed a mystery, from the time when chromosomes first began to be investigated in the latter part of the 19th century until only approximately 25 to 30 years ago. I discovered, as you have heard, as a postdoctoral fellow at the Laboratory of Molecular Biology in Cambridge, England, the way in which nature has solved this challenging problem. Now, if you stop and think about how it might be done. Well, the first idea that I think would come to your mind of a way in which to compress, to accommodate a long thread-like molecule would be to wrap it around a spool, as one does actually with sewing thread or what have you. But the problem that would create is how the cell, when it requires information from a gene located in the center of the spool, may gain access to make the relevant protein encoded by that genetic information. Nature's solution of the problem, as I discovered in my postdoctoral studies, is the creation of many spools, not a single large spool, but many small ones, such as those pictured here. So from a combination of biochemical and X-ray studies, I was led to propose in 1974 the wrapping of DNA, shown here as a kind of gray thread, around a set of 8 protein molecules. The proteins are known as stone molecules, in a unit that has since been termed the nucleosome. This unit is the fundamental particle of the eukaryote chromosome. It is the basis of coiling DNA. Many such tiny spools are then arrayed in linear fashion, and then as shown in this picture, further coil to arrive at what is ultimately the condensed state of chromosomes you saw in that microscope picture in the previous slide. The beauty of this mechanism that nature has invented for the purpose, it allows on the one hand packaging, so condensation, and on the other hand selective unpackaging, so it's possible to unravel one spool without effect upon the others. So to gain access to one bit of information without disturbing the condensation of the rest. Now it has since emerged from the work after 1974, and in particular from studies I performed in the mid-1980s with my longest and closest collaborator, my wife, Yali Borch, that the nucleosome, this unit of packaging or coiling DNA, is important not only for condensation, but it actually performs a regulatory role. So it literally prevents expression of all the many thousands of genes in our cells, except those whose activity is brought about by specific positive mechanisms. And that has been the purpose. It's been the object of work done ever since in our lab and many others, and work that is still ongoing. Once the DNA is made available by unraveling one or a small number of nucleosomes, then it is a target for transcription by RNA polymerase for creation of the genetic message and ultimate translation into protein. Our work over the past 20 to 30 years has been in part concerned with discovering the molecular structure of the RNA polymerase so as to understand the mechanism of transcription. Now, for this purpose, it was necessary to create an organized, a crystalline form of the RNA polymerase. This was a challenge that occupied more than a decade. And you see here pictures of some of the very first crystals that we obtained by a procedure I won't have time to describe. This was around 1990. These crystals, as you see, are about a tenth of a centimeter across, which is an appropriate size for solution of their structure by X-ray diffraction. Now, because of the giant size of the polymerase, I told you it is made up of a dozen individual protein molecules, we required a very intense source of X-radiation ultimately to solve the structure. The X-rays were available to us from the linear accelerator at Stanford. In fact, you can see in the background the mile-long Stanford linear accelerator, which culminates in the foreground in a ring passing around the buildings in the center. Electrons circulating around that ring give off X-rays of extraordinary intensity. Within one of those buildings underground, we then have access to those X-rays They are shown upon one of the crystals you saw in the previous slide. The X-ray photons that then scatter off the crystals are collected on a detector, and the pattern of the scattered X-rays is analyzed by computation. At the time when we began this work, there were no computers powerful enough to analyze the pattern of scattered X-rays from an object of this size. It was only in about the year 2000 that all the requirements were met, X-ray beams of sufficient intensity, detectors for the scattered X-rays sufficiently rapid, and finally computational facilities available to compute such a gigantic problem. The structure that we solved contained originally 10 of the 12 proteins that make up RNA polymerase. We could since add the remaining two. It contained 28,000 atoms, and the result of our work was discovering the location of every one of those 28,000 atoms. This is a picture of 28,000 atoms. This shows the first conclusion from the work. Now, a better way to understand and interpret this picture is to trace the paths of the individual protein chains through this pattern of atomic positions. And that's shown, should have been shown in that slide that we see here. Okay, so the two slides that come in between are actually movies, which unfortunately I can't present, but this slide will suffice. So what you see in white and gold is the path we have traced of the protein chains through that arrangement of atoms. This picture goes a step further. So the culmination of our work was revealing this atomic structure, not of the RNA polymerase on its own, but as you have heard from the kind of reduction, the RNA polymerase in the act of transcription, reading the genetic information, transcribing the DNA sequence into an RNA molecule. What you see here is a trace not only through the many atoms of the structure, not only of the path of the protein chains, but also of the DNA and RNA chains present in this structure of the actively transcribing RNA polymerase enzyme. So in green and blue, you see DNA, and in red, you see RNA. And what you will notice is that the DNA double helix in the structure enters from one side, and then, as I indicated in the schematic diagram, the RNA polymerase separates the strands. The one in blue, the DNA strand in blue, can now serve to direct the synthesis of the RNA strand, shown here in red. That, as I say, was the culmination of our work. It is the picture for which the prize was awarded in 2006. It brings me to the end of this very brief introduction, and with that I'll be more than happy to take your questions and to engage in what I hope will be an enjoyable dialogue. Thank you.
That very fascinating account of your discoveries over 31 years, I think. That's 31 years of very hard work condensed in a few minutes description. It's a pleasure now to open this dialogue session, and I'm sure Professor Kornberg welcomes questions, comments, discussion. When you do, can you please identify yourself so that we roughly know where you come from and your background, but please don't take too long over that and keep your questions brief. Would anyone want to start? Yes, over there. Thank you.
Hi, good afternoon. I'm Lutfi Toila from the International Islamic School, the teacher there. My question has two parts, actually. It's going to be very brief. First of all, do genes fundamentally determine our behavior? If they do this, does this mean that people who have maybe genetic violent tendencies should be watched more often than others? And the second part of this is that if education and societal pressure teach us to repress tendencies that go out of the social norm, for example, violent crimes, now, is it unhealthy for people to repress this genetic behavior? Thank you.
Yes, interesting.
So the answer to the first part of your question, there is
we think little doubt that genes play an important role in behavior. The evidence for that comes, of course, primarily from studies in model systems, where the behavior of creatures as simple as worms or fruit flies has been examined in detail. Then by inference, we have come to think, and I believe it is widely accepted, that genes also play an important role in human behavior. There are studies that have been done to address the very question that you ask about the role of genes in aberrant behavior, including aggressive behavior. There are syndromes, genetic syndromes known, that do clearly correlate gene content, if you will, chromosomal composition, with aggressive tendencies. But beyond that, we have at present very little detail. One of the concerns that scientists have when such information comes to light, it may be misinterpreted. It may be assumed that people who behave in a certain way are incapable of any remediation. We have no information that would indicate anything along such lines. And I think that we can look forward to two things in the future. One, to a deeper understanding of the relationship between genes and behavior. And then to a way of putting such information to the best use, which is, and I would emphasize, no longer the responsibility of scientists, but rather of society.
An interesting and always disturbing aspect is how much of a person's behavior is due to nature and how much due to nurture. The eternal question there. Are there further questions along this line?
Or any other?
Or any other, yeah. Yes, please.
Good afternoon, Prof. Met a guest. Hello, colleagues. My name is Dr. Abubakar. I'm a PhD student in Kornberg, UKM. I have two questions for you. The first question is regarding the another Nobel Laureate award to Andrew Fire and Craig Mello on RNA interference. I think it was done at the same time with your own. So I would like to know whether there's any relationship between your work and what they have done with RNA interference. The second question to you is regarding microRNA gene expression data and other pathway analysis tools that are available on internet and also from private companies. Do you make use of them in your own lab?
So the second question is relating to what information? Tell me more.
The second question is regarding microRNA gene expression.
microRNA.
Yes, microRNA.
Microarray.
Yes. And pathways, studio solutions that are used to analyze the gene expression data, whether you make use of them in your own lab.
Yes. So in answer to your first question, the studies of Fire and Mello, which revealed the existence of a process called RNAi or RNA interference, we now recognize as one example of a far broader phenomenon, which is the regulation of gene expression by RNA molecules acting on their own and unrelated to translation, to their having nothing to do with their translation of protein. The regulation of transcription or gene expression in general by RNA molecules is an area of intensive study at the moment. Our own work indicates that RNA molecules may play a role, for example, in the selective unraveling of genetic information in DNA nucleus. There's no doubt that RNA molecules play roles at every subsequent stage in the control of gene expression, culminating at the end in RNA degradation through RNAi. RNA molecules are evidently, or our regulatory role for RNA is evidently important, as I say, in the first step. It's important, and there are RNA molecules that can control transcription per se. There are RNA molecules, portions of RNA that regulate the stability of the product RNA at the end, or even the process of transcription itself, which can be interrupted partway through. So there are indeed many interesting relationships. There are many important connections between studies of transcription and what was originally emerged from the work on RNAi that has since been extended in many directions. Now, in regard to the second part of your question, microarray analysis is by now a standard method for us and for others. We use it all the time. We employ it in a variety of contexts, one of which is to look at the selective unraveling of the information in nucleosomal DNA to determine which portions have been made available, under what circumstances, in response to whatever condition we may create in the test tube or investigate in living cells in vivo. So yes, microarray analysis is a routine method that we and everyone else interested in the subject that I study regularly employ.
There's another question.
I'm Dr. Abhi Virupasivam from UPN. My question is, what is your view on using microarrays for global profiling of gene expression, which is really a snapshot in creating molecular portraits for cancer diagnosis, therapeutic utility, as it stands?
There is no doubt there's a lot to be done in that direction in the future. And some of the most interesting work in the past few years, of course, was related to breast cancer, where there's evidently important predictive value regarding the prognosis of breast cancer patients to be gained from the pattern of gene expression revealed by microarrays. One of the limitations of such analysis is precisely what you said. It represents a kind of snapshot. It doesn't show the dynamics of the process. It doesn't even show the full dynamic range because microarray analysis is for the most part limited to a fairly narrow span or range of gene expression, RNA level of gene expression. Nevertheless, it is a method whose time has come, and there's much to be gained from its extension in the future. It's, as you know, still a technology almost in its infancy. There are a number of approaches that are employed. I imagine that there will be new, more powerful versions that emerge over the next several years. They will become faster, more routine, eventually possibly a value also for investigating dynamics of the speed and ease of doing it become sufficient.
Thank you.
Any
further questions? Yes. Professor Cole.
Thank you very much. Cole from UKM. Professor Kornberg, the discoverers of DNA, structure of DNA, James Watson and Francis Crick. We are not from genetics itself. Francis Crick is a physicist, and James Watson, his background is on ontology, study of birds. What do you think of outsiders encroaching into a territory and yet make a fortune out there? Is it very rare, or is it one of the things to be encouraged by researchers, especially in science or genetics for the matter? Thank you very much.
So it is, in a way, not uncommon. In fact, my own experience is viewed as almost an example of that. When we undertook the study of RNA polymerase structure by X-ray diffraction, we had no previous experience of performing X-ray structure determination, and the people in the field who were all experts were somewhat skeptical of the undertaking. I think that the moral of the story is the pursuit of a problem, whatever it may be. What matters really is interest in the question and dedication to the pursuit. The methods are available. They're relatively easy to learn. One can always find a place or a person to teach them. As an individual researcher, you need only set your mind on achieving a particular goal, and then, as I say, follow whatever path is most expeditious towards that end. It will very often result in your doing things that you didn't know how to do in the first place, and place you in the position of a bird watcher that you alluded to, or the physicist, venturing into territory which is, at least in the beginning, unknown, and most often populated by people who are not only expert, but may even jealously guard their turf. I think the most important thing in the end, as I've said, is a focus on a question, on a problem that fascinates you. It's pursued wherever that path may be.
That's great advice. The importance of not being too jaded in your own techniques, because sometimes an amateur actually comes along and sees things much clearer. That's a question that yes.
I would like to just follow up on the discussion on microarray analysis to understand gene expression. How do you foresee this new technology called transcriptome sequencing, which is now available to understand gene expression, now that we have this second generation sequencing available, which can be done more rapidly? Is this being utilized in your laboratories?
That particular approach is not used in my own work, but it's coming into wider use in other labs, as you mentioned. In fact, one of the remarkable, one of the most notable characteristics of molecular biology, of the chemical science that underlies it over the past several decades, has been the way in which it advances in directions at a speed and ways that no one could have anticipated. So I can recall as a graduate student in the 1970s, trying to devise methods of DNA sequence determination, because it was obvious that was something important to do. Then in the mid-70s, the first methods of sequence analysis were discovered by Watson and Miller and Sanger. They were very cumbersome. Over the next 20 years or so, such methods were expedited. None of us could have dreamt of what is now or about to become possible. So, as you may have read, this has obvious commercial benefit, and there are many biotech companies now competing to accomplish what they call the $1,000 genome. The point probably well known to you, the first sequence of the human genome was determined a few years ago at a cost of many hundreds of billions of dollars. Over a period of years by a very large number of investigators, many of them funded by the American National Institutes of Health, some privately. What is going to be possible within the next year or two will be something comparable to the determination of the sequence of a human genome, only instead of taking years, it will take a week. Instead of costing hundreds of millions of dollars, it will cost $1,000. This will transform the science that we do and have a profound impact on medicine. The march of technology is something utterly remarkable. Again, things that when we could not have dreamt of are now possible. Now, it brings me back to a question that was asked earlier about genes and behavior. One of the limitations of neurobiological research has been a lack of methods for understanding the mechanism of the nervous system and in particular the complexity of the human brain, I think that while today that still represents a significant challenge, it's a safe assumption that methods will be found that we haven't dreamt of that will also permit us to analyze the patterns of neural activity and ultimately understand the basis of cognition, of behavior, and so forth. The example of DNA sequencing really serves to illustrate the never-ending surprises and seemingly unlimited ingenuity of people for addressing these issues and solving the problem.
Yes.
Yes, we're from UM. Just following on that question, you see now that in this day with all these technologies and functional genomics and all that, we should no longer be looking at genome projects, but really looking at, we should really concentrate on comparative genomics and functional genomics and understanding genome rather than doing more genome projects.
So when, I mean already, from the many genome sequences available, quite extraordinary insights have emerged. These were genome sequences largely determined by the pre-existing methods. They were all often determined at great cost and time, effort, and money. There is no doubt that when sequencing becomes as rapid and routine as I mentioned, we will enter another realm and the kind of comparative analysis that you refer to will become routine. At the same time, one must never lose sight of the importance of problem solving in a way that it has been done in the past and will always be done in the future. So rapid methods of genome sequencing will yield a lot of information that will be fascinating to analyze. But many of the underlying problems concerning genome function will remain. Just to give you an example, the most fundamental question about genome function and expression has to do with the way in which information beyond the DNA sequence has an effect on what people refer to as epigenetic information. Sequencing the genome will not be sufficient to explain its function. Even at the very first level of unraveling the DNA for expression, we know that there are layers of additional information that are imposed and that may be inherited in certain ways. And these are not amenable to analysis at present by the rapid methods that are under development.
Thank you. Yes, a question from the front end.
Good afternoon. My name is Sarina Zulo from the Genome Center in Science Malaysia. I'd like to ask regarding the involvement of the hypermethylation process and which has a role in the regulation of the gene expression. So I'd like to know if is there any effect to the nucleosome if we can manipulate the methylation process.
So the question refers to one example of epigenetic information, probably one of the first that was discovered, in which modification of DNA influences the pattern of expression. It is indeed believed that methylation can have a direct effect upon the accessibility of DNA, its packaging in nucleosomes in the one area and or unraveling on the other. One of the proteins that plays an important role called heterochromatin protein 1, is recruited in a manner that is dependent upon a pattern of methylation. We believe that protein plays a role in the establishment of what is referred to as constitutive condensation, not sequestering genes to prevent their activity or in the life of cell organisms. But this is only one and very limited example. Methylation is a very hot topic in that area of study, and I sense that you are involved, and I would encourage you to go on.
Thank you. That's very encouraging. Further questions? If not, can I just chip in a little bit? Oh, okay. Yes, there's a question there.
My name is Aramiriya Parag. This question I'm posing is already posted on my website, compassions.googlepages.com, compassion with a Z at the end. It's about this question of whether it's evolution of the human species or revolution of the human species. considering the complexity of the human DNA and all life forms, DNA and genome. Could it be possible that all this happens by Darwinian evolution purely by chance? If this is so, as I stated on my website, if intelligence, orderly design can spring up from total disorderly human chaos, why aren't all the planets throughout the universe teeming with life? That's one thing I posed. And also, I also stated that it cannot be purely by chance, because it's common sense that less intelligence can only come from a great intelligence. I mean, how can you have things like intelligent life and scratchers coming from a primordial soup of basically random things? If this can happen, then even on the coldest planets, you can have life forms coming out with its own antifreeze on other planets with its own naturally selected antibody. So what I'm aiming for is that there tends to be intolerance by evolutionists against the teaching of intelligent design in schools and so on. There should be greater tolerance, because in nature, we have to consider two things: the possibility of evolution by chance and the possibility of revolution by intelligent design. In fact, in nature, we know from the Cambrian explosion that is the equivalent of the Big Bang when it comes to creation of life. It did not happen like the Big Bang. It did not, the universe was not there all the time. There was a moment of creation. And in biological nature, the same thing. It's Cambrian explosion. There was a moment of creation.
Yes, I think
you're
opened up a very important
area. You ask part of, in a very broad sense, you ask a question to which I have no answer. So I can't really rest with the heart of what concerns you. I can only tell you a few things which you probably know already. One is that evolution, in the Darwinian sense, is well documented. You ask whether it is sufficient to explain all of what lies before us. Again, that's a question I can't answer. I mean, the evidence for Darwinian evolution is absolutely fascinating and written in the genome. There's a paper you may like, you may look at in a recent issue of Science magazine, showing how it was possible to reconstruct a half billion year old version of a modern gene from comparative genome sequencing, and then to understand how through evolution it gave rise to the modern day molecule. This was based upon reconstruction of the original gene and then actual crystal structure determination of the protein that it encodes. This is one of many examples that modern science has produced clearly demonstrate the occurrence of what I'm probably referring to as Darwinian evolution. The broader question that you ask, whether any other factors could come into play, is one that science can't answer. We're limited only to the things that we can test, we can observe directly. We can't, neither I nor any of my colleagues interested in the particular question that you ask, can go beyond the facts before us. We can only reason from the information we gather and what we know. We can't either rule in or rule out broader hypotheses, such as what you have proposed. You know, it's interesting when you look at the structure of the RNA polymerase that I showed, to ask the very question that you've done: could such a thing possibly have arisen? Something so complicated, and a molecular machine so intricate, and with capable of such amazing coordinated activity. Could such a thing have arisen by Darwinian evolution? There's only the beginning of an answer to that question with the studies that have been done just in the past couple of years on RNA polymerase structures from related or simpler organisms. The full answer to the question has not yet emerged.
Thank you. Yes. Another question?
for gene therapy. So I'd like to listen to your opinion on this gene therapy. How successful is this gene therapy nowadays? And what should be the focus and future of this gene therapy research? Thank you.
Gene therapy is an approach which is not yet possible in a general sense, but whose time will come. I think it's clear to all of us that methods will be found to accomplish that, only that they do not exist at the present, or to the extent that it can be done today, only in a very limited way. And there are many components to the problem. One is the delivery of a gene, another is its proper integration in the chromosome, and lastly, and not less important, control of its function. Now, there are new methods being devised to overcome the problems to which I've alluded. For many years, they seemed to be virtually insoluble problems. But as I was saying only a few minutes ago about the rapid advance of sequencing technology, this too seems to be an area where what was once impossible may now readily be done. So there are, again, biotech companies that have developed new methods of delivery of nucleic acids to cells that look very promising. And that major obstacle will very likely be surmounted in the next short period of time. There is a particular biotech company in Richmond, California, near Berkeley, just north of where I live, that has already implemented a spectacular technology of directed integration at a site of interest. It can be any site you wish within the human genome. So one by one, these obstacles to gene therapy are being removed. And I think one can say with quite some certainty that this important approach for molecular medicine will be achieved.
Thank you. Yes, so the three hands we have left. Sorry, hand back us.
For Kornberg, I'm from UMBI, UKM Materiality Institute. I'm a student. My question is, can you please elaborate a little bit more on the mediator complex, a complex called mediator in your research? And I understand that it plays an important role in a kind of on and off switch for the transcription process. And my second question is that looking at the amazing structure of the RNA polymerase, as you showed just now, it somehow reminds me of a quote by Sir William Hamilton. He says that the highest reach of human science is the scientific recognition of human ignorance. So as a scientist and an individual researcher, this whole experience has become a... Thank you.
So first to the question you asked about mediator, which is in a way pertinent to the second part of your question. This was something utterly unexpected, which emerged from our work about 20 years ago. It was previously thought that the molecules called gene activator and gene repressor proteins that turn genes on and off in our cells and those of other eukaryotic and organisms in particular exert their effects directly on RNA polymerase to control transcription, to either facilitate or inhibit transcription. We were surprised to find in the late 1980s, to discover the existence of something entirely new that serves an intermediary role that goes between the activator or repressor and conveys the regulatory information to the RNA polymerase on a gene. In retrospect, we can understand why such a thing exists and we can appreciate its importance. So, a human gene or that of any other complex organism must not only be turned on and off but at the right place and the body at the right time, to the appropriate extent, and in a manner that is sensitive to environmental as well as internal metabolic influences. In fact, we now know that a typical human gene is regulated by not one activator or one repressor, but by many that enables such a finely calibrated response and such appropriate regulation. The mediator, as an intermediary between the activator or oppressor and the clonase, then receives multiple inputs, is the target of the very many regulatory proteins that come into play to control the expression of a single human gene. The mediator is a kind of molecular computer. It receives and processes this complex pattern of regulatory information and then delivers a single coherent signal to the RNA polymerase that results in the right amount of transcription, as I say, at the right place, at the right time, and what have you. Now, the challenge before us today is the mechanism of that computer. We would very much like to understand, indeed, one of the main objects of my current work is to figure out how this completely new kind of computational device executes its important role. Bear in mind, the same mediator controls the expression of every gene in the body. It's a computational device which has been conserved through evolution. That same molecular computational device is present in plants and animals. So understanding how it works is indeed an important object of our work. The complexity is very great. The mediator is made up of more than 20 different protein molecules. In some human cells, as many as 30 or even 35 protein molecules. This is a giant molecular assembly, as fits its fundamental, very important, and seemingly complicated role. If any aspect of nature can be humbling to the investigator, certainly it is the mediator, both because of its extraordinary complexity and astonishing function, and because of the incredible challenge of trying to understand it.
Thank you. Yes, there's a question from the website.
My name is Shah. I'm from Forbes magazine, and my question is more general. I mean, what's your personal opinion on science and religion? Do you see it as two opposite sides of the pole? If yes, do you see when can we have like science and religion confirm each other rather than tolerating each other?
So you're present. You're probably not present in the morning when.
Yes, I'm sorry.
Were you present in the
morning? No.
Because I made some comments along those lines, and I'll only briefly summarize for your benefit what I said at the time. I pointed out that there is much more in common between science and religion than most people generally imagine, and there are also important differences. I pointed out what they have in common is the purpose of explaining the mysteries of life in the world around us. Both are faith-based. In the case of religion, we know it is the faith. In the case of science, it perhaps needs to be explained. I'm not sure that's what I mean. We as scientists have the purpose of understanding, for example, everything about living things in chemical terms. We have the faith that that may be done, but there is no assurance we will achieve it. So we're motivated by a faith as well. And then I emphasized that both are done and only successfully pursued with what I can only describe as passion, with dedication, and zeal, and love for the subject. where they differ is in the kind of information that they accepted when the conclusions drawn, which relates to what was asked earlier this afternoon about intelligent design. It is the, as it were, the defining characteristic of science as I practice it, and most of the rest of the people in this room, I'm sure, that it is limited only to what we can directly measure or verify by experiment. And so science can go no further. Religion may not be limited in that way. It may know no such bounds. As a scientist, I must live within those limitations.
Thank you. I believe there's a question from that side of the
My name is Rafid Karim from International Islamic School. I'm doing my A-levels right now, and I have a question which is related to activation of genes. I've read in a recent issue of Reader's Digest that autism is actually not caused by missing genes, it's caused by dormant genes. And by training a child, you can actually activate those genes. And scientists are looking to the possibility of making drugs which would activate genes. My question is that most drug designs are copied from nature, and are those activating drugs found in nature, which I think was answered, and is it possible that humans could someday make a drug that has the opposite effect, repress cancer genes maybe?
Yeah, so you're in the first place, the broad answer to your question is absolutely, we should be able to cure not only autism, but virtually every other disease, whether genetically inborn or the result of infection or what have you. Infection, mutation, whatever that may be, whatever may occur in life. There is absolutely no doubt in my mind and that of most people practicing science such as I do, that what I have mentioned can be achieved. Now, whether it will involve gene therapy because of effective gene, such as was asked a moment ago, or control of gene expression, as you have just suggested, in a case where the genome is intact but the molecules that regulate its activities are in some way aberrant or altered. That we will only know when we analyze a specific condition in more detail. When such information is available, and if modulating the pattern of gene expression is required, there may well, there's no doubt that drugs or drug-like molecules can be designed for the purpose. The challenge really lies not at that level. The challenge is more fundamental. It's what, in a way, you alluded to. We don't yet know what is the basis for autism. We don't know which genes. We can't be sure what is the problem. And until we do know, there will be no possible way forward. So in this case, as in so many others, the limitation is not in the means available to us, but in the basic information that underlies the use of whatever means we may bring to bear on the problem.
Thank you. I think we'll let the gentleman have a question.
Okay, Tuan Loy from International Medical University. Professor Kornberg, just now you mentioned in your lectures that the DNA is actually 1 meter long and you compact into a single cell. But we know that many genes in eukaryotes not coding for anything. They are nonsense genes. So why do eukaryotes carry so many, such a burden of these unnecessary genes? And do you think that one day such non-coding genes will be activated again? Good for something.
So the question that you ask is on the one hand even more acute because of information gained recently, and on the other hand less so. I'll explain. It used to be thought that there were perhaps 100,000 genes. Now we know there are probably only 30,000 genes to directly coding for proteins in the human genome. So even more of the DNA is unexplained than in the past. But on the other hand, in recent years, it's emerged to what extent untranslated RNA molecules that do not code for proteins play key roles in the regulation of expression. So we can't actually say at the moment any of the DNA to which you refer will be properly termed junk as was once done in the past. It may be that all of the DNA performs an informational role, only much of it functions not to code for proteins, but to regulate the expression of those proteins. So these are outstanding problems for ongoing research.
Yes. Hi, I'm Uwe Morawetz from UCSI University. I actually have a question in regards to the mediated molecule that you have mentioned over again. Does it have anything to do with microRNAs or any other molecules that will probably be working together to co-modulate transcriptional factors during the transcription of the gene? And my second question is a more general question for most postgraduate students here. In regards to what is the interesting field that you would recommend for us to go into after we finish our studies? Thank you.
So in answer to your first question, it would not be surprising if it emerged RNA molecules, non-coding RNAs that perform a regulatory role in certain effects directly upon the mediator. We are certainly alert to the possibility. We haven't discovered such a thing, but we may. Discover that in the future. So that remains an interesting open question. In regard to the second part of what you asked, what would I do if I were your age? Starting new science today, what area would I go? And on the one hand, I would perhaps offer an inadequate answer. I would say everything is interesting. I mean, there isn't any problem in science if one undertakes it that isn't ultimately as interesting as any other. It's all, I mean, nature is beautiful, and the challenge of understanding is always a great one, and ultimately meeting that challenge is immensely rewarding. But now, to be fair, to answer your question more directly, I'll tell you what are my own interests. I'm particularly fascinated by the chromosome as an organelle, not as a monolinear DNA molecule, so to speak. But in its remarkable dynamics, I think it is properly viewed as the largest organelle of a cell, larger than a mitochondria, larger than any other object. That its transformations, its dynamics underlie just about everything. And so part of the purpose of my own work is to contribute towards understanding that. And if I were starting all over again, or if I were 40 years younger at 25 again, I would probably still like to do that. That represents a particular choice based upon my own history. And again, I would emphasize, I don't think I've heard about anything from anyone relating to a scientific problem that I wouldn't be engrossed by.
Yes. My name is Abdulhadi from UKM. My question is, since you are very good and expert in gene expression, and do research in gene expression, there is actually a lot and many kind of vector that can be used to express a gene. And usually the researchers know why they use that type of vector to express the gene. The problem is, what would you do if there is one kind of gene that can be expressed have two or three type of vector, and then two or three type of vector can express the gene? Would you use all these type of vector, or you just pick one vector to express the gene and you proceed to the next step, protein AC. And is that going to be an argument when you publish a paper or do a presentation?
As you properly observed, there are often multiple methods, and probably in some cases multiple routes to the solution of a problem, and anyone that gets you there will suffice. All that matters is if you wish to express a protein, as you have indicated, you know the amount you require, the purity is you desire, and whatever else it is, impose limitations. Any method, any vector, any organ, any host organism, any approach that you use which will satisfy your particular requirements will suffice. You can be concerned about choosing the optimal vector, you only need to choose one that works.
I'm going to now exercise the chairman's prerogative and slip in one question. It's not a detailed question of gene expression, but perhaps a good question to end up with. And that is with regards this question of passion for science. We know that young people today have so many competing distractions, activities, careers, and so on. There's so many choices, many of which pay a lot more than what scientists and researchers will ever get paid. So how can a country like Malaysia, which is developing, we have limited resources, we don't have a fantastic record in science, although I'm sure we are capable of a lot of things. How can we help our young people develop this passion for science?
Such a thing as political science or other intellectual activity, or indeed any pursuit, is inexplicable. People discover this in themselves, and the only thing we can do as administrators or as educators or whatever role we play is to recognize it and nurture it. In a country like Malaysia, I am certain that there are many people who might prove to be passionate about science or other academic or many activities. They don't know if they didn't get the chance even to explore that, but at least to try it. So the first rule of the education is to try and expose. And those who do prove to have such an interest and desire, and as I said, you need to be encouraged. I don't think it's something that you can inculcate. I don't think it's something that you can teach, but I think it's something that you can encourage, and recognize, and promote. Above all, I think at every level, what is most important is personal freedom. It's the freedom to try, the freedom to choose, the freedom to quit, the freedom to change. And of course there are limitations. There are limitations of resources, there are limitations of facilities, and all of those things. You do the best you can with the most limitations.
Thank you very much. I'm sure there are many more questions, and I did see many other hands halfway raised, which I had to suppress. I do apologize for that. But I've been reminded to keep fairly close to time because Professor Kornberg has a very tight schedule. And according to the program, I have to sum up at 4:15, and I guess scientists have to be a bit more precise about it, concise about what they do. So I will have to stop the discussion now and do a very quick summary. I think we've had a fantastic session, even if the time was somewhat limited, don't you agree? And I must congratulate all of you, and I must say that I've been very pleasantly surprised that you've had so many questions, and I'm very grateful to Professor Kornberg for a really know, giving so much thought and sharing so much in his services. I think we have covered a very wide-ranging number of topics, even though the dialogue is supposed to be a research on gene expression. Gene expression is very broad anyway. We started with the genetic basis of behavior, balance of nature and nurture, and went into some details of techniques like microarray analysis, methylation, functional genomics, comparative genomics. Discussed also some of the limitations of a snapshot, non-dynamic kind of analysis, problem solving. The concept of problem solving and the quest for information and knowledge, and the passion for science, which cannot be inculcated but has to be nurtured, has to be recognized, has to be promoted. And lastly, in our age of recycling, can I just remind all of you that junk may also be very valuable. And there may be a lot in the junk that we carry in our DNA that is going to turn out to be extremely valuable, maybe gold dust in the future. So can I ask you to join me in thanking Professor Kornberg for his work? For your participation and for your enthusiasm and for making this such a splendid session. Thank you.